Welcome back to the Roll Less Taken Roulette. I thought I was going to say something clever here, but I got nothing. I'm Mike, I'm the MC, and would my players please introduce themselves so I could stop talking?
I'm Tom, and clever as Bever.
And who do you play?
Take that. I play Ross Roberts. He paints the sky with Beverly Hills blue. Oh.
Wow. Hi, I'm Megan, and I play Bear, and I'm just going to pass this on to Graham.
Hi, I'm Graham, and I play Finch, the pan-dimensional boy.
Hi, I'm Peri, and I play Lemon.
Before we do our recap, everyone leveled up last time. Every single party member leveled up. So we're going to discuss what people are taking for their level up bonuses before we get into the role-playing proper. Let's start with... let's go backwards. Peri, what are you doing?
I'm going to take a new gunlugger move, and I'm going to take Battle Hardened, which says when you act under fire or when you stand over watch, roll plus hard instead of plus cool.
Finch, what are you doing next? What's your level up bonus thing?
I am taking a move from the Savvy Head playbook called Things Speak, and basically it lets me ask more questions about stuff instead of people.
Bear, what are you doing for your level up?
I am taking a move from another playbook. I was frantically trying to find the playbook I took it from. I don't remember what the class is, but I think it's from...
That was from an extended playbook, right?
Extended, yeah. It was from like a limited or one or the other. But I took a move called Clear Eyed. And when I roll or when I read a person, I roll hard instead of sharp, which benefits me because my hard is plus three.
God, everyone in our party is a bunch of like hard motherfuckers. Actually, it's mostly just Baron Lemon.
I'm just weird.
Yeah, it's Baron. We've got two hard characters and two weird characters. That's what we've got.
I was just going to say, make sure you let everyone know that's from the Space Dolphin playbook, where you play as a dolphin that returns from the moon to help reclaim Earth in the name of Dolphinamity.
Yeah, was that the Space Dolphin one?
It was. Well, it wasn't that class, but that class was within the same playbook, and I don't know why you say it like it sounds so preposterous.
The Space Marine Dolphin?
Yeah.
Only because I'm not yet a Space Marine Dolphin. I've just been waiting my entire life to become one with the dolphins.
Oh, you're going to be really happy with the next NPC I introduce then. I'm not being serious. I'm not introducing a Space Dolphin. I'm sorry. And Ross, what is your level up doohickey thing?
I took an incredible ability that's very complicated. It's called Get Plus One Cool, Max Cool Plus Two. And now my cool stat is at plus one.
Nice.
But in order to use that stat, I have to look at my character sheet and remember that the number says plus one now instead of zero.
I am making a note of it. It now says plus one instead of zero under Ross Roberts' cool stat.
I did all my complicated shenanigans earlier on.
And now you're like, I'll just take a stat point.
Yeah, I you know what? I do things under fire enough that it makes sense.
All right, now that we've gotten all the level up shenanigans out of the way, let's roll for that recap.
Oh, no.
That sounds promising.
Off to a great start.
Everyone tell me your numbers before I tell you mine.
You tell me mine, I'll tell you yours.
Oh. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. That's not good.
I got a six.
I got a four.
I got a three.
I got a one.
Oh. Meanwhile, I rolled an 18.
Wow, that was just... terror across the board, but I had everyone beat with an ace in the hole, or a hole in an ace, as the hole maybe.
You had so many opportunities to succeed.
I had 20 opportunities to succeed, actually.
You blew all of them.
I guess three, if you had, what, you had a four or a three, Megan?
I had a three, yeah.
Yeah, so I had three spots on that 20-sided dice that were go tell the mountain the story of what happened last week, and I hit on the most prominent one of them. Alright, so, recapping the events from last week, we set about looking for a safe passage to Lemon's family estate, the name of which I am forgetting. Peri, if you could help me out.
Peri won't know.
Blackwell, probably.
Yeah, Blackwell. That makes sense. I just forgot. We were looking for safe passage to Blackwell, ended up settling on securing the services of some kind strangers in exchange for Lemon's money, because who doesn't love to spend Lemon's money? They took us as far as a mountain crossing where we had to make our way on foot a ways before we could get picked up by another caravan. I believe Finch may have eaten some fruits in the back. We all went about on our way and got attacked by lizard men who threw grenades at us. Ross tried to kick a grenade. It didn't work out super well, but he didn't get exploded. There were some other explosions that went on, and we murdered crazy sadistic lizard men that kind of just wanted to die for a good amount of time. And then interrogated them a little bit. Found out, I believe, Lemon... did Bear find out, too, about the Blackwell Labs or something like that? And I think that was about it.
It was a very combat-heavy episode.
It was pretty combat-heavy.
It was.
I've noticed that in a lot of, like, actual play RPGs, or tabletop RPG podcasts, whatever the hell you want to call them, if there is combat, it's usually going to take up the whole episode.
It's so complicated. That's why.
It's not even that complicated in this system.
Complicated enough.
I think we work extremely well together when we're killing other things.
We need to have a catalyst for our murder.
Otherwise.
Otherwise, we find one and it's each other.
That's right.
Oh, there's no problem to face. Let me start one.
All right. So we are going to resume the role play right after the aftermath of the battle with the lizard men. Whereupon Lemon and Bear discovered that these lizard men were tattooed with a logo for something called Blackwell Labs, and Ross just painted a weird picture of dead lizard men and regular lizard men, like, eating them and bathing in their blood and stuff.
Can I ask a really important question about the tattoos?
Uh-huh. They're not temporary.
Lick them and stick them?
No. What font are the letters in?
Comic Sans.
Yeah, fuck if I know. Like, why is that important?
Impact, size 20.
You can tell a lot about an evil mastermind by what kind of font he uses.
Is it Cyprus? Did they use Cyprus?
Papyrus.
Helvetica?
Guys, I have a Bachelor of Arts in professional writing, and I don't know typefaces, so.
What is wrong with you? You don't use defonts.com as, like, your source for all font material?
Just, it's fine.
Calibri?
Times New Roman.
Times New Roman 12 double spaced.
That would tell us a whole lot about who we're fighting.
Yeah, exactly.
One, he has a graduate degree. Two.
That kerning is super nice.
There are two spaces after each period.
One, he got a graduate degree before 1994. Two.
Take that, graduate degree holders pre-1994. The role less taken is onto you.
Old ass MLA handbook. I don't actually know when they switched it over, but that's how you...
The references are sorted Chicago style.
Monsters.
Psychology degree. That's no good.
All right, now that we've alienated like half of our listener base by talking about...
Including ourselves.
Yeah, fonts and indexes. I don't fucking know.
Welcome to the Font Less Taken, a podcast within a podcast about fonts. This is our last episode.
I enjoy.
The font is that.
All right, I'm going to sign up. Could good. Just be bonus content.
I have tears on my glasses. Shit, I've got the giggles.
So Finch is really hurt.
Yeah, everyone's got harm. Everyone got hurt.
I got punched twice.
Yeah, I'm at like 6 o'clock.
I'm at 9.
You are really hurt.
I'm pretty fucked up.
It sucks.
Yep.
I still don't understand how the damage clock works.
Okay. So when you fill in the first part of the clock from 12 to 3, that's basically like superficial harm. Like, okay. It doesn't really matter.
Would that be if I took, like, one harm?
Yeah. So that's one harm. That means you're, like, bruised. But, like, you're pretty much fine.
Okay.
When you fill in from 3 to 6, you're starting to show some, like, real damage. And it's still, like, okay. You'll heal over time. When you fill in from 6 to 9, you're starting to get pretty fucked up, and you will not heal naturally over time. You need someone to actually heal you.
Okay.
Any medical attention.
Yeah, like medical attention or some sort of healing ability or someone with an angel kit, etc. You need that to happen, otherwise you're not going to heal. And then from 9 to 12, it's split up into three more sections, which is where shit starts going real bad. If you fill in the last or the next two sections, that is when life becomes untenable. You have to decide to take some sort of penalty or decide to retire or just let your character die. And if it fills up all the way, you're just dead. You don't get a choice.
Okay.
See, I was just going to joke that when it gets to 12 o'clock, it's time to die. That's how the clock works.
You're right. When it gets to 12 o'clock, it's time to die. So Finch already had to fill in one of his, I guess we'll call them penalties. He chose a loophole that basically made it so he comes back with plus one weird, even though his weird is already maxed. And I allowed it because I am benevolent.
I didn't want my hard to go down anymore because it's already negative one. So Finch needs medical attention.
So we're like immediately after Ross's painting?
Yes.
So I guess Ross, like, snapping back from the experience of tapping into the weird, would start to kind of survey the surroundings and kind of take stock of everyone's condition. Be like, is everybody all right? Finch, you're looking a little messed up there, little buddy.
Yeah, it hurts.
Let me see if I can do something about that. I do have the Angel Move Healing Touch, so I would probably go ahead and use that on Finch. I am trying to see what the technicals of it are, and my keyboard's about to go clickety-clack.
Do you want me to read it to you?
Sure, I would love that.
When you put your hand skin to skin on a wounded person and open your brain to them, roll plus weird. On a 10 plus, heal one segment. On a 7 to 9, heal one segment, but you're also opening your brain, so roll that move next. On a miss, first, you don't heal them. Second, you've opened both your brain and theirs to the world's psychic maelstrom without protection or preparation.
Woo! I got like a... I got a 12, so...
Alright, you heal one segment, so Finch, you can erase your harm clock down to 6 o'clock.
So Ross just like will, in an interesting fashion, just kind of like touch the paintbrush to his tongue. And then just kind of like wipe like a wet brush across like Finch's wounds.
Aww.
And even though it seems kind of odd, he's just like, that ought to help. It's a special kind of paint if you're thinking about it. A little something from the psychic mother within us all.
That was a little bit weird, but okay.
Unsanitary.
Do you feel better?
Yeah. Yeah, a little bit. Gets up, he's still limping a little bit, but he starts like walking.
Ross just shrugs. Seems like it's working.
All right, so does anyone else want to do anything, or are you just going to move on?
Yeah, do we know where we're going from here?
I have a note to ask Alistair
about Blackwell Labs.
If he's ever heard of Blackwell Labs.
You're not going to get away with I do that.
No, but is he around or is he still like hiding somewhere?
I think after he realizes that the lizard men are dead, he'll put in an appearance.
Megan was with me when she saw it, or Bear?
I saw it. Well, Bear, yeah, Bear saw it, but she's not saying anything about it right now.
Well, Lemon doesn't know anything about this, so she doesn't really care who overhears. Alistair.
Okay, so yeah, he, like, toddles over. Don't forget that he's an older dude. He's probably in his, like, early 60s. He's still, like, a little beat up. If I were to say what his harm clock was at, it's filled to 3 o'clock still. He was messed up, like, before you guys ended up leaving Roulette. And he did get healed, but not a lot of time passed, so.
Okay, that's fair. So I'll show him the tattoo. Like, I'll bring him over to one of the dead bodies. Like, it's weirdly lift up the shirt or whatever we did to find it out.
Woohoo!
Yeah, it's like on their pecs, like on their left pec, I guess.
Peel it back again, like a...
With like a serial number?
Saran wrap.
Ew.
What do you make of this, if anything?
Oh. Oh my.
Have you heard of Blackwell Labs before? This is new to me.
Oh, Miss Lemon, your parents were...
I do hate it when you start sentences like that.
I'm just being polite, is all I can say. Miss Lemon, your parents were involved in some interesting activities, And I believe that when they disappeared, left, died, I'm not quite sure what happened to them. They said that the labs were closed, and not to mention this to anyone. However, it appears that word's gotten out.
And it would also appear that the labs may no longer be closed, unless this means something else. What else do you know about these labs? What were they doing? It surprises nobody here that they were into some sketchy things, I assure you.
Your parents were trying to, I suppose, correct, perhaps, the damage that your grandparents caused the world. Now, as you know, your grandparents, well, look around. This is what they did. Your parents were trying to find a way to destroy or incapacitate the vessel, and they got into some interesting research when it comes to biological weapons of something that might be able to defeat that horror that we call the vessel.
Did they leave any of their research notes behind? Also, did they have proof that destroying the vessel would undo all of this? I have never heard one way or the other what would happen.
Well, as for notes, I don't actually know where the lab is or was. It's possible that there are notes in the lab, wherever that is. I have to imagine it's somewhere near the Blackwell Estate. And as for the other question, I have no earthly idea about that either. I suppose destroying the vessel would at least eliminate the threat of the vessel.
Or?
Or?
It would let something out.
Something?
I don't know. I'm just saying. A vessel, usually, it's called, we call it the vessel, which may just be a misnomer. But vessels usually contain something, do they not? And when you break a vessel, whatever it contains spills out.
Right. Now, I don't know if that would be for better or worse then in that case.
I'm just hypothesizing. Either way, I suggest we all keep walking. It doesn't sound like we're going to get any answers from these gentlemen. She, like, indicates the incredibly dead lizards.
No, it, looks like they're about as dead as, well, some of the rocks and streams I like to paint on a beautiful, lovely desert scene, even though it's, well, quite perished, as I've just mentioned.
Wait, rocks aren't dead? What?
You mean to say rocks are alive?
Huh? You've never noticed? Oh, okay. Finch just shrugs and starts limping away.
No, no, come back here. We're not finished with this conversation.
What?
I'm just curious what behavior you have witnessed from rocks that indicates to you they are alive.
Oh, sometimes they speak to me or something. I don't know.
All right, let's keep walking.
I wish rocks would speak to me. Oh, well.
So, yeah, you guys are going to continue your way through the mountain pass. Do you just leave the dead bodies where they lie?
I'm going to burn them. Can we burn them?
I was going to look on the way out for, like, tracks, if there was anything to identify where they came from.
That's not a bad idea.
So, just give me a sharp roll. This isn't, like, a read a sitch. I just want to get some ideas.
Yeah, 6.
Well, here's the fun part. That's a highlighted stat for you, so mark experience.
Yeah!
But no, you don't notice anything.
I'm a smart cookie, just not a very sharp one.
Before we leave, I would either try to burn the bodies or at least burn off the identifying marker that says Blackwell Labs.
You just take like a knife to the chest, you're like, no, I don't like that, and you start shredding it.
It'd be terrifying.
No, because I don't know who else is going to come across it. You don't leave clues as to your family's dark past lying around, oft-trod.
I do.
That's true.
Do I have to roll?
No, my only, like, I don't, like, what does it take to burn a body? Like, it has to take a certain amount of sustained heat for so long, right? I think that'd be pretty difficult.
Right, if I wanted to cremate them, I don't. I just need people not to be able to identify the marks, and if I wanted to, I could only burn the chests, right?
You could just, like, pump some rounds into them and shred their chest, I guess. I don't know.
Sure. I don't want to waste bullets, though.
As we established last time, I'm not allowed to put ammo restrictions on anyone, so whatever.
Okay, then I'll just, I'll write something else over it.
Not Blackwell Labs. Just write not above it.
Anyway, I deface them somehow.
So, yeah, as you make your way out of the mountain pass, off in the distance you can see the next, I guess, supply stop or courier stop. It's a combination of both, I think, where, you know, people are going to convey you to Blackwell proper.
How many more of these stops do we have, Lemon? Are we getting close?
This is the last one. This will take us to the gates of the estate.
All right. That comforts me a little bit, like a happy little tree. Given what we've just been through, I'll be happy not to see any more of those unfriendly little lizard men.
Likewise.
What were you doing back there, by the way, with the...
Did she burn him or shoot him? What are we settling on?
I don't know. It's up to her.
I have a machete. I could just, like, score it until it's beyond recognizability. I probably would have done that. It's the least amount of fuss.
What were you doing back there hacking up their bodies anyway? I didn't really catch the gist of that.
She was covering some family history.
That is an excellent way of putting it, Sugar. Correct.
Oh.
They had tattoos, and I have recently learned that those tattoos led to some of my family history, and I don't like leaving family business lying around for other people to find.
Ross looks like a little disappointed, and
just thought it was the bloodlust,
and just like looks off a little bit, and is like, so. In addition to having the source of the source of the apocalypse in your basement, you also have a lizard man cloning machine somewhere. And one that makes lizard man that don't like you? Is it because you made him? Is it because the shade of green on him is just an off-brand emerald green and not a proper scaly reptile green? I would understand that kind of anger.
Plum, I frankly just don't know. This is all news to me. Do you know everything about your grandfather? My grandfather started the apocalypse, and let me tell you, he was a tight-lipped man, never mind that I never met him. My parents likewise died when I was very young, being foolish as their own parents.
I'm pretty sure that my grandparents died in the apocalypse that your grandparents started.
That would track, yes.
I just want to say that the lizard men, if I could describe their colors as Ross might, the two shades I would use are Mountain Dew, Baja Blast, and Mountain Dew.
I know exactly what you mean when you say that.
They're very vibrant. Unhealthily so.
Just covered in yellow five.
Okay, so as you guys get closer to... Did we give this thing a name last time? I feel like we did. Yeah, it doesn't matter. So as you guys pull up, it should be bustling, but you're not seeing anyone. It seems quiet.
This is a very bad day. I would just like to state on behalf of the group, this day is not going very well.
Is this not a normal thing?
No, absolutely not.
Overjoyed.
Can we read situations?
Megan, is that what you were going
to
say?
Yeah, I was going to ask if I could like check to see if there's anything noticeable.
You guys can do read a sitch. I'm saying both Bear and Finch.
This is sharp, right?
See.
I got a 9.
Okay, so you will get to ask one question.
I got a 10.
Okay, so Finch will get to ask 3 questions along with one of his sniffing the air questions. Of course, if you can't think of enough to ask, that's also fine. So, the questions are, of course, what's my best escape route /way in/way past? Which enemy is most vulnerable to me? Which enemy is the biggest threat which might apply? What should I be on the lookout for? What's my enemy's true position and who's in control here? I'm going to say Bear can go first because she only gets to ask one.
What was the one? What should I be on the lookout for?
That is one of them.
Can I ask that?
You can ask that, because it's one of the questions that you can ask. You look around the area, like, you guys are pretty much at the building now, and it looks kind of just like, almost like what a general store nowadays would look like, but they're not charging for anything, they're just delivering things. It just looks like abandoned. Like, there's fresh stuff there. There's goods out, like, on the counter that look like they were being moved around. Like, you find a cart that was moving, like, canned goods around just sitting in the middle of the floor. It's like everyone that was there and everything that was going on just kind of stopped.
Okay.
So one of the questions was, what's my enemy's true position?
Uh-huh.
What is my enemy's true position?
So you're going to take a look around and take stock and try and figure out what happened and who's around. And as far as you can tell, nothing's amiss except for the fact that the place seems totally abandoned. So as to your enemy's true position, wherever it is, it's not here right now.
I'm trying to remember what the other questions are because I've already forgotten.
Escape route, way in / way past, which enemy is the biggest threat, who's in control here, and also you get your like unique class question.
I think I might hold one. I'll ask, even though I'm pretty sure the answer is nobody, who's in control here?
Jesus.
Yes. Jesus Christ.
Ross?
No. We're not going that far yet. He's only the king of roulette. You find on the ground, Finch, some lizard scales that look awfully familiar. They're a bright Baja Blast type shade.
That actually kind of answers one of the other questions on my sniffing the air. I was going to ask what or who is the source of the most pain or fear here, but I think that's the scales. So I might just default to how close are the wolves. Finch is always worried about those wolves.
They're not here, but they're close.
I think Finch, like, stands up with the scales in his hand and he goes, I know the wolves are close, and also these are somewhere.
Hell.
I agree.
So on the plus side, even though everything has been abandoned and there's no one around, there's still some vehicles here that you can commandeer if you want
to. Yeah!
Absolutely. Who can drive?
Finch is an excellent driver.
No.
He drove that one time.
He drove that bike that one time, yeah. And did pretty well. It was impressive.
It's better than Ross.
I think all of you know how to drive. And the other thing you can consider, first of all, these cars are all automatic. I'm just making that a ground rule right now. No stick shift. There's no real, like, obstacles for you to worry about. It's not like there's a ton of traffic that you have to worry about crashing into, unless you're like Tom when you play DayZ and crash into all the trees everywhere somehow.
Turning is hard.
Yeah, I agree. You could fly. I couldn't fly, but I could drive.
Is it like that scene in Bob's Burgers where, like, there's one car in the parking lot and Bob is just trying to get Tina to pick a direction?
Tina, turn the wheel!
Pick a direction.
I'm sure it is.
Pick a direction. But yeah, there's like two vans that, like, you know, are very nondescript that you can take if you would like to. That way you don't have to walk.
Can I check the place quick for corpses or signs of violence?
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to check for signs of more lizard men. You know, I know Finch noticed scales, but I wanted to see if there was, again, anything like trails.
Give me sharp rolls. All of you. Finch, I don't know if you're doing it too, or if you've sated your curiosity.
I'll roll again.
I got a 9.
And that's a highlighted stat for you, so mark experience.
Oh, yeah.
I got a 10.
I don't know if anyone else has doing things, Big Bear.
No.
I don't know if anyone else has sharp highlighted.
I got a 9 as well.
I got an 8!
I still have a hold from my last one, though.
Bear and Lemon, you guys are searching for corpses. More is that that's what you said you were searching for. You do not find anything. You find no bodies or anything like that.
Okay.
Ross and Finch, you guys take a look and see that there are some faded footprints that are leading back in the direction you came from. So, like, back towards the mountain pass that you emerged from.
Like, they're heading out towards that direction, not coming to town from that direction?
Correct. They're headed towards the mountain pass.
Okay. So away from us.
Yes.
Ross just kind of wipes the sweat off his brow looking at the tracks.
What were they wearing?
Leather armor, right?
Like heavy leather vests and also like Incredible Hulk pants that no matter what size they grow to, they always stay intact around the crotch.
Hey man, Lizard from Spider-Man had the same pants. Very apropos.
Mm-hmm.
I was just making sure that one wasn't dressed like a truck driver.
Nope.
I was concerned about spontaneous transmorgification.
I get that. I think I would like kind of wait for everyone to get back from checking things out, but I'd be ready to head off in cars if we found the cars. You know what, Ross, I'll just go saunter off on his own over to one of the cars and just kind of hang off on a side of it.
Oh no.
Just waiting for everyone else to get back. Are they like white cargo sniper vans?
That's what I was picturing.
They have wizards painted on the side.
No, these are not airbrushed, sorry.
Aww.
Anyway, Ross would just go hang out buy one of those vans, wait for everyone to finish their business, and start like looking for a way to start up the vehicle.
You pull down the sun visor and the keys plop out.
Oh, cool. Ross just shrugs and fires up the van.
As you turn it on, the radio springs to life and you hear, "Here in my car, I feel safest of all. I can lock all my doors. I don't know the next line.
In cars.
Da 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 da."
Ross starts grooving along with the track.
"I do feel safe in my car. It's a great car."
Bear hears the music and pokes her head outside to see Ross sitting in the van, head bobbing. I imagine, like, is he drumming on the steering wheel?
But just, like, that kind of, like, light, like, finger tap drumming.
Right,
the only thing that's moving is, like, index and middle finger.
I actually do have a question. Did we bring any gang or cult members with us that have just been not helpful for this entire time?
I did not.
Nope.
I had forgotten.
They had other stuff to do.
And the DM praises the sun. So is everyone going to pile into the vans?
Yeah.
Are you taking one van or are you going to take both? Just so I know.
Should probably take two.
I can drive the other. I don't mind.
All right.
Finch is grabbing something edible off the counter and eating it on the trip.
Who's going to come riding along in my frosty white vehicle of night and motor transportation?
Finch, you find a bag of, like, old pretzel rods. They're a little stale, but perfectly serviceable.
Pretzel rods are always at least a little bit stale, but always satisfying.
So, who's in what van? Alistair is going to go in whatever van Lemon's in, just as a rule.
In the interest of keeping the peace, Lemon would probably go with Bear.
Finch is going to pile into the other van.
The Rossmobile? If this van somehow survives, it will have Ross's face painted on the side of it by the end of this adventure.
It will soon be airbrushed. Bear, you're driving in front with Ross following along because Lemon has to give directions on how to get to wherever the hell you're going.
That makes sense.
Are we ready for a fun road trip? I'll let you pick the music.
Bear just starts revving the engine.
God, what would Finch listen to?
Like theremin music?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, you guys pull up to Blackwell, and God, like, I don't think Peri and I described it a huge amount, but it's like just a huge ass house. Like Victorian, we decided, right?
Oh yeah, she's old money.
Is it like a mansion?
Oh yeah, it's huge. And like, it's not just a house. Like, there's a servant's quarters off on the side.
Stables.
And fields of whatever you turn into alcohol. I forget, there was like a 20-minute discussion on what kind of alcohol your family produces.
I think as soon as like Finch sees it, he kind of like turns to Ross and goes, "What town is that?"
"My town."
I don't rightly know. I've never really been out this way, Finch. I hope we're getting close to wherever it is Lemon's trying to guide us, though.
What the fuck is this monstrosity?
"That is the Blackwell Estate. Welcome to my home. You may pull right up to the main gates."
Bear does as she's told.
Jurassic Park theme intensifies.
All right, so you pull up right at the end as it's turning minor key because you pull up to the gates, which someone should open for you, and no one's coming to open the gates.
Fucking shit! The stage just gets worse and worse.
Is there a problem, Lemon?
There are many problems today. Lemon's gonna get out and open the gates herself. She's gonna, like, kick them open. Fuck this fucking... She, like, gets out of the car, like, perfectly... Just a minute, sugar, hold on. She gets out, and she's like, dunk. And she's perfectly calm, and she, like, walks up to the gates, and she just kicks the shit out of the whole thing open, and then she calmly walks back.
Bear looks at Alistair with, like, an uncomfortable silence and just shrugs.
He smiles at you, he's like, "Oh, I've known her for a long time. This is just her way. Don't worry."
She apparently doesn't have any manners, does she?
Oh, she has manners. She just chooses to ignore them.
That's very obvious.
Sounds about right.
Ross just looks over at Finch and is just like, well.
Finch just nods.
That's it.
That's about what I would expect, I guess.
Bear drives in.
Yeah, so where do you have them pull up to, Lemon? Just in front of the like main entrance to the house?
Yeah.
Okay. So you park your vehicles and get out, and are you just going to head on inside?
I'm going to arm the fuck out of myself first, and I'm going to indicate that the others should do likewise.
Are you waiting for us all to go together, or?
Nope. I'm like guns out, one in each hand, and I'm through the door because my sister is supposed to be in there.
Sun's out, guns out.
I'm going to check her room first.
Bear sees Lemon, you know, preparing for battle, pulls out the sawed-off shotgun and kind of like rests it on her shoulder and casually like follows behind.
Ross is also marching forward with his magnum.
Finch has his knife out. I was going to say, should somebody read a sitch?
Somebody probably should. This is probably a good idea.
You hear Alistair say like, I think I'm just gonna stay in the car if that's all right with you until I know the situation's clear.
Hey, take this. And Bear throws the machete to Alistair just in case things get, you know.
He doesn't actually try to catch it. Like, he lets it clatter.
It just hits the dirt.
He lets it, like, clatter to the ground and then he picks it up from there. He's like, well, I hope I don't have to use this.
Me too.
Ross, like, just nods at Bear, like, good idea.
Bear would... So, Lemon is just going in. She doesn't... She's not looking at anything. She's just, like, preparing and just entering, right?
Mm-hmm.
Can Bear take a moment of caution and try to assess the situation?
You want
to
read a sitch?
Yeah.
Do it.
This is probably how Lemon dies, actually, because I'm at 6 and I didn't get healed.
9.
9. Okay, so you get to ask one question. You'd think I would just keep it open at all times, but...
You would think I would remember.
Oh, no, you're not going to remember, like, 9 questions. Don't worry about it.
Who remembers things?
You guys can't remember what happened last week. You're not going to remember.
Hell no.
Can't remember the name of my hometown.
Your questions are, what's my best escape route / way in / way past? Which enemy is most vulnerable to me? Which enemy is the biggest threat? What should I be on the lookout for? What's my enemy's true position? Or what's in control here? Who's in control here? Or what, I guess.
The first question. So that wouldn't necessarily just be escape. That could be with, like, entering the property as well.
Uh-huh.
I'd like to ask that question because I don't know the property.
So, I mean, Lemon just went in through the front door.
Mm-hmm.
This is a house that's big enough that you can see that just on the side of the house where you are, the front of the house, there's also 2 other entrances. And if you're feeling froggy, you could also probably climb up to a balcony that's up on the 2nd floor. So there are several different ways you could get in to the
house.
Don't
be a frog. Don't do it.
No, I won't take that risk.
That's where Finch was thinking back on.
Finch, remember what happened last time you were Batman?
Finch has put his mask back on.
Bear's going to follow Lemon, but keep those other places in mind just in the event that they need to use them.
Okay.
Can I, since I've been doing it multiple times, I want to do it again and look for any traces of lizardmans.
Ooh.
You can do it. That, yeah, just give me a sharp roll.
Bam! Oh my god! That was terrible. That was a 3. That was 2 ones.
Well, mark experience. Yeah. You would have marked experience whether you passed or failed, because it's a highlighted stat. But yeah, you don't notice any signs of lizardmen. Of the Dublasts. Oh, that's their name!
The Dublasts?
Dublasts.
Yes.
Can I do something with my hold?
It depends what you want to do. Tell me what you want to try and I'll let you know.
I mean, I was thinking about trying to read a sitch. Or just trying to ask one of the questions with my hold.
Oh yeah, that's fine. You can just ask a read a sitch question or one of your sniffing the air questions with your hold if you want to.
Yeah, why don't I just do a scan for the wolves again?
Oh my guy, they are close.
It sort of figured as much. I mean, if the other two are still around, I might just kind of like tug on one of their sleeves and say like, I think the wolves are here.
You could say it to Ross. I don't think Ross has gone inside yet.
Yeah.
Do we need to do anything special about the wolves? Or do we just splat their brains like that fella on the side of the road?
That'll do it.
All right. You happy with your armament there, boy?
Do I actually know how to use guns?
I think you've used one before. I think they've given you one. Yeah.
Yeah, you took my shotgun.
Yeah.
I think I have another pistol, so I could hand him a pistol.
Yeah, you have a 9mm that you found way back in Source.
Ross will just hold it out.
Finch will, like, shrug noncommittally. Finch takes it.
Okay, so do you have the stats on that, Tom?
Yes, it is. 2 harm, close loud.
So that's what you got now, Finch. You got a 9mm. Levin, as you are, like, charging through the house...
Guns up, by the way.
You're not seeing anyone. Like, you don't see any of your maids or your butlers or your, I don't know, chefs or servants or...
Fox and Turk.
You don't see anyone. What floor is Cricket's room on?
17th.
I think she was on the second floor.
It's not that big of a house.
62nd floor.
It goes out, not up. It's a mansion. She's on the second floor. That's where the bedrooms are.
Okay, so yeah, you go charging up to Cricket's room. And again, you haven't seen anyone. Bear's pretty close behind you as well, kind of keeping watch.
Yeah, Bear's following suit.
Ross and Finch, are you following as well?
Oh yeah.
Or are you going to stay?
Ross is heading in.
Okay, so you get to Cricket's room and the door's closed.
I'd like to open it.
Okay. You try to open it and it's not locked, but it feels like there's something like fucking heavy barricading the door. And you hear Cricket go, "Who's there?"
Cricket is Levin. What is going on? Cricket, she's like,
I don't know. Hold on. And you hear her like straining like really hard to like move something out of the way of the door. And she opens up the door and she just like runs out immediately and hugs you. She's like, "Oh, Jesus, thank God you're home."
One gun arm around the sister. One gun arm still up.
What does Cricket look like?
What does Cricket look like?
What does fucking Lemon look like?
Lemon is fit fat and she's got black Satan eyes. Does Cricket have Satan eyes?
I don't know.
we never really established this. Okay.
Family trait.
Family
why not?
Trait. Yeah.
So she there's like a definite family resemblance, but Cricket's been sick her whole life, so she's not as Lemon's pretty tall. Cricket is not. Cricket is much more petite and sort of not even svelte, just like thin in the way that someone who's been ill for a long time.
Bear looks at Lemon hugging Cricket, and Cricket just goes, "It's not your mini me."
Shit, because Lemon is not answering. She's just like, "What the fuck is going on?" She probably doesn't even hear that.
Cricket's gonna see Bear and just like back and be like, "Who's that?"
"This is a business associate of mine, Bear. This is Cricket. Cricket Bear."
Charmed.
Hello.
Finch is gonna walk up and just be like, "Oh, hi, Cricket." Like he's known her all his life.
She's gonna like squint at you and be like, "Do I know you?"
"Oh, I'm Finch. I forgot we hadn't actually met."
"I am hating this conversation."
"Yeah, I'm feeling a little uncomfortable now, I gotta say."
If Lemon doesn't see any, like, immediate threats, she's gonna put one gun down and just sort of, like, check Cricket over for any injuries.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone punch you in the teeth? Or her teeth, okay.
She's like, you're peeling back her lips so you can look at her teeth like she's a horse.
Gums are pink.
I'm like, face, arms, turn around, any blood?
She seems fine. She seems shell-shocked, but like, otherwise, there's no physical harm.
Okay. I'm gonna give her a gun.
Yeah, she handles it like professional. She's just like, "Oh, nice." And she's like... I don't know what you give her, but, like, yeah, she's just completely comfortable with it.
I have an extra shotgun. I give her that.
Yeah, she just, like, pumps it once. She's like, "All right, I feel a little better now."
Ross just kind of arches his eyebrow at the scene and just says, "You didn't have your own guns just around the house? You had to wait for your sister to bring you one?"
I barricaded myself in my room and...
"You didn't have a gun in your room? I've been around this one long enough to know she doesn't go anywhere without five of them."
I do some funny stuff in my sleep sometimes, and I didn't trust myself with a gun in the room."
"We have different roles in the family."
As long as this, like, Lemon seems genuinely not affected by this and believes it, then I'm fine.
Lemon's gonna be like, "Just wait here a second, sugar, all right?" What would I call Cricket? I would just probably call her...
Probably just Cricket, if I had to guess.
Well, actually, I'll take everybody down to the first floor. And then on the first floor, I'll, like, go towards the basement.
Uh-huh.
And open the door. And I'll tell Cricket to stay. "Wait here just a minute. Want to check out downstairs. I will be right back.
What's going on right now? We're just being told to stay put. Where are you going? What is happening? Is there a painting by one of the great masters down here that we should be aware of? Is this where the unholy grail of worldly destruction is being kept? What the hell?
Lemon gets about halfway down the stairs and then, like, sighs and turns around and is like, all right, Ross, Plum, if you would like to come with me, you can. Bear, I would appreciate it if you stayed with Cricket until we get back.
I would enjoy knowing where I'm going and why before I go.
You are going to see the vessel.
Finch is already, like, right behind you.
All right, I'll...
And then we go check on the vessel.
You twisted my arm, I'll go.
Bear's gonna wait with Cricket and ask if, would you like to meet the VP?
Cricket's actually, like, a little distracted at first. She's just, like, looking around. She's like, where is everyone?
I don't know. Is it normally pretty bumping in here?
I don't quite know what bumping means, but there's usually at least some sort of activity going on. Lemon employs, like, 40 people. It's strange. I haven't seen a one.
Is it like a gang?
No, it's a strict, like, boss-employee relationship.
I'm a boss.
Sure you are, honey.
What? Why'd you lock yourself in the room?
Well, someone told me to. Someone that Lemon employs as security told me that something was going on and that he would come back to let me know when it was safe.
When was that?
Yesterday.
Oh, thank God. I thought she was going to say 8 years ago.
Oh, that'd be some real fucked up shit.
Did you hear any noise?
No more noise than usual. But given what we keep downstairs, I take these security warnings quite seriously.
Sounds like some fucked up shit in the basement.
Oh, you have no idea.
Anyway, would you like to meet the VP?
Who's the VP?
Bear just opens the satchel and His Holiness pokes his head out.
Oh, she immediately goes into, like, any human around a cat mode. Like, oh, kitty! And she just, like, bends over and starts, like, scratching his chin and all that good cat stuff.
He's happily purring.
All right, so let's switch to the scene down in the basement.
Are Fox and Turk anywhere?
No. So you go towards where, you know, the vessel is held, and the wall is just, like, fucking exploded. Like, the door, the heavy-duty door with, like, the 18,000 locks is gone. There's no trace that it was even there. Most of the wall is just blown out.
Can I tell if it was blown outward or blown inward?
Outward.
Fuck.
Ross just looks over at Lemon and after seeing that and says,
I take it your architects didn't exactly paint that into their original workings of the manor here?
I have not seen the original designs, but I would guess not. Can I see, is the vessel there or is it an empty room?
As you get closer to look inside, it's an empty room.
Shit.
Is there any shrapnel about?
Can I see if there's drag marks on the floor? Or, God forbid, whack-ass feet marks?
Non-Euclidean feet marks.
Distinctly whack-ass.
Roll sharp.
You can't. Well, give me a sharp roll, actually. Please.
It's too dark. 5.
You cannot discern any, like, any footprints or any tracks at all. It's just, like, upstairs and, like, trace of anything living besides Cricket. Like, she's the only person you found. There's no, like, it looks like the vessel is just gone. It looks like you haven't seen anyone, and they're just gone.
Are there any, like, is there any, like, shrapnel or any, like, inanimate objects that I can, like, pick up and examine?
Lots of pieces of wall.
Yeah, lots of pieces of wall and, like, broken bits of, like, heavy metal and locks that were part of the door that got ram-jammed, I guess.
So is it, like, something bored into the wall and, like, there's an open air component? Or, like, what's the...
It's like something exploded is what
it's
I was
like something that was inside the room, didn't want to be in there anymore.
Huh, I wonder what that could be.
Fuck. Yeah, can I use my new move? My thing speak move? Whenever you handle or examine something interesting, roll plus weird. On a hit, you can ask the MC questions. On a 10 plus, ask 3. On 7 and 9, ask 1. And the questions are, who handled this before me? Who made this? What strong emotions have most recently been nearby this? What words have been said most recently by this? What has been done most recently with this or to this? And what's wrong with this and how might I fix it?
I like that last one. That's just like, well, this wall's broken. I guess if I get some spackle and shit, I could... Right?
On a miss, it's like I've opened my brain to the maelstrom and missed. So, fingers crossed.
Yeah, do it up.
That would be a 15.
Alright, so ask 3 questions.
I would like to know what has been done most recently to this. I'm holding like a lock, I think.
You get like a sort of psychic vision, not like you fully open your mind to the maelstrom. You just get an image of the door and the wall just like exploding outwards with the velocity of something very fast. I don't know. Heavy as a very heavy thing.
What words have been said most recently near this?
You hear, like, a pretty violent pounding, and then two voices just being like, oh, what the fuck? That's not okay. What's happening? And then you just hear this loud, like, deep, inhuman roar.
Cool. I'm going to go with the what strong emotions have been near this recently.
Is hatred an emotion?
Yeah.
Just like some deep, dark, fucking black hatred.
Yikes.
Something hated this room, and people were confused and scared, and there was a loud roar. And he kind of just puts the piece of metal down.
Lemon just starts, like, cussing. She just turns around, starts, like, making her way, like, back upstairs, just, like, cussing all the time. And, like, in between the cussing, you hear sentences like, I should have let that asshole Coldwater execute me last year, but I wanted to see Cricket married first. And, like, all the way up the stairs.
That sounds fantastic.
Ross is just, like, sighing, like, looking around the room. Is there anything, like, of note? Not necessarily related to what may have gone missing, but, like, anything that Ross might find, like, interesting? I mean, is there anything else there aside from, like, the destruction? Or is it just...
Give me a sharp roll, first of all. This episode is called Investigating a Mystery, so you have to be smart.
Investigation Discovery, aka Ross rolls a 5, which is not good.
You notice that the air is very dusty.
It's not... I can't even paint that. It's not... I hate everything about this place.
Ross just kind of trudges back upstairs following Lemon.
Upstairs, in the, I don't know, I guess it's like a dining room or something, Bear and Cricket are there, and Cricket's still like fawning over His Holiness Lord Roadkill, and you could hear Lemon like storming her way up the steps, like boom 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 footsteps, and like
she's not happy. No, not even a little bit.
Vehement expletives.
I feel like His Holiness does not like Lemon. They haven't formed a connection.
Bonded.
So as soon as you hear Lemon, like, storming up from the basement, His Holiness immediately hides back in my satchel.
Aww. Cricket's just like, aww.
She has that effect on him.
She has that effect on a lot of people.
So the party reconvenes in the... whatever room you're in. I don't know. I said dining room, so we'll just go with that.
Is there a sweet candelabra in there?
There's a bomb-ass chandelier.
There is a bomb-ass chandelier. Lemon would lead everybody to the kitchen, probably, and just, like, immediately start making tea.
What happened down there?
The vessel is gone.
Ross starts, like, rifling through the pantry.
Saltines, 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 saltines. Champagne, saltines.
Ross starts eating saltines.
So she puts the kettle on and she sits down and at like the table that the servants usually use, and she's like, the vessel is gone. So as far as I can tell, is everyone else on the property?
Oh shit.
That's what I said.
Cricket just like sits down heavily in a chair, just like that, like, I need to sit because I just experienced some bad news. Sit.
She gets tea first.
Finch very helpfully adds, it kind of hated that room, I think.
I should think so.
Ross's eyes go wide as he slowly inserts a saltine into his mouth and bites down on it. But his eyes just remain wide.
Yeah, so Lemon is going to bring Cricket the first cup of tea, and she'll be like, tell me everything that you remember.
It was sometime yesterday, I think it was the evening, and it sounded like there was some kind of commotion going on. I wasn't feeling great, so I was in my room resting, and I got up to see what was going on, and I poked my head out the door, and I heard Fox, he came upstairs, and I don't think I've ever seen him upstairs before. He told me to block the door and stay in my room, and that he would come back when it was safe again. And, well, he never came back.
Ross's eyes go wide as he puts another saltine cracker into his mouth.
Cricket, like, keeps looking over at him because she, like, she doesn't know who he is at all, but he's been there. And she's like, I'm sorry, who is that?
He's a weirdo.
Well, yeah, but...
Another business associate. His name is Ross.
Oh, hello, Ross. I'm Cricket. I hope you enjoy those crackers.
Her cracker. Not a matter. God, dark is a pretty dry.
Right, okay. Could you get him some tea, Lemon?
I bring Ross some tea.
Ross gives a thumbs up with one hand and puts another saltine cracker in his mouth with the other.
He's just got the wad of unswallowed cracker in his mouth.
Oh, that's so gross.
It's just getting harder and harder to chew.
All right, you better hope you don't have to sneeze anytime soon.
Her house, not mine.
When Finch gets a cup of tea, he's gonna take like a handful of the like dust from the basement and just like stir it in and then start drinking it.
The
also,
teacups,
will that trigger my intimacy move?
No.
Ross looks over at Finch, though, as he does that and says, after he's had a sip of tea, of course,
remember when you told me to tell you when you eat weird stuff?
Oh, no, that was if I act like somebody I'm not.
Oh, I thought it was because you were eating bugs and strange things, but I guess eating ceiling dust is okay if you say it is.
I don't think it's okay.
I don't either, but, Well, if the boy wants to paint his insides with a little bit of cement gray, that's just all right.
Also, these are the fanciest teacups you've ever seen.
Go ahead, describe the teacups. You sound excited.
No, they're just the fanciest fucking teacups you've ever seen. Like, they're the kind that, they're like that sort of like bone china that when you pick them up, you're like, if I squeeze too hard, this is definitely going to shatter in my hands.
They're the ones that are usually kept in the cabinet when your grandma goes, oh no, those aren't for using. We just look at them.
Yep. Right, except in Lemon's family, these are the everyday ones.
Finch, of course, doesn't know enough to know that, so he's just like drinking tea as though it is normal.
He eats it like in the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
What's Bear doing?
Bear's reserving her cup of tea for His Holiness. She like sets it gently on the counter and like pulls him out of the bag and sets him down and opens up a can of Spam to let him have a meal and stretch his legs and enjoy some tea.
Ross puts another saltine cracker in his mouth.
So, Lemon, what the fuck are we gonna do?
That's an excellent question. I have to think about that.
Is there any idea of who might have taken...
fucking cracker mouth.
Or where it would have went, or what might have happened? I heard... Oh, Lemon, I heard you say... something about knew you should have killed yourself earlier. Is that whole sacrificey deal you were talking about?
Yes.
So?
My death is supposed to prevent this exact problem, or at least a similar one. We never did find out what the problem was because the last two generations we've been dying on time, and I thought I still had a couple months left. By the calendar, I should have been all right.
Is there any more you could do to paint a picture exactly of what this problem is, or are we already at about all we know about it?
Well, the first problem started the apocalypse, and we didn't want to finish the apocalypse, so we've been dying in order to keep the pause on the apocalypse.
So...
And that's about all we know.
You're telling me our lovely little canvas of hell is somehow about to get worse.
Well, I cannot say for sure, because... I have no way of knowing what it looked like the first time, and I certainly have no way of knowing what it would look like if it would have happened this time, but I would not call this auspicious.
You and your sister, I'm sorry, and Cricket, sorry if I'm being informal in a house of delicacy, but you seem like a house with a history, and I'm just wondering if, you know, you have some tomes or paintings or any sort of journals that might tell us more about what happened the last time, if you don't happen to know off the top of your heads, just anything that would help us find what we're looking for.
He puts another saltine cracker in his mouth.
I assume that those would have been part of a Lemon's original education, right? Like anything we had in the house.
Yeah, but it's always possible that there's more out there, I guess. I mean, you just found out that your parents had a secret lab that you knew nothing about, so...
That's true.
This is like some Resident Evil tier shit here, so, you know.
Do you think we should ask Alistair, since he seems to know more than he's letting on?
Everyone forgot he existed until you just said his name again.
Of course we did.
Like, while we're going to get him, though, Finch is going to pipe up and say, we could ask the lizard people.
Why, are they here?
I don't think so, but maybe they know something.
Are you haunted?
Haunted by lizard people.
What's so
an erotic fan fiction.
Are you fucking possessed? You used to
you
be
used
my
to
brother.
Be my father.
I don't know why this just occurred to me, but Finch, didn't you say your friends, the Happy Little Wolves, were nearby too? Do you know how close they are? And maybe we should get Alistair inside the house.
Yeah, Lemon's gonna get up. Because she didn't know about the wolves. She's going to hear that and immediately go find Alistair.
I don't think they're very happy or very little, but yeah, they were close. Do I have like a sense of how close? Like, you know, like within a half mile?
Probably within like a radius of a quarter mile, I would say. I don't know. I don't want to put too fine a point on it, but they could be closer than that.
I mean, I was a little bit wondering earlier if there was a way for me to just like do a scan for them with the maelstrom, just like... I don't know, like overlay the world and pinpoint them on a map of the maelstrom.
Oh, so you just want to open your mind to the weird to try and
figure out where they are in relation to us, yeah.
Okay, yeah, you can do that.
Oh, it goes fantastically. It goes 5.
So you go into like a zone out where you have a whole psychic maelstrom vision, and you hear the mother's heartbeat again. And it's going kind of fast, like, at the level of, like, someone who is mildly stressed out, but not, like, you know, at the height of terror or anything like that. And you listen, and you see it in that tree that you've been drawing since the beginning of the campaign. And the vision fades, and you can still hear the heartbeat, and it's getting quieter. You can still hear it, and you tilt your head to try and, like, hear where it's coming from. And that heartbeat is coming.
Nope.
It's the exact same timing as Cricket's heartbeat.
Nope.
Bear, you were... No, who? Someone was going outside? I'm sorry. To get Alistair?
Lemon said she was going to... I'll follow Lemon too, just as like, you know, so we're not going alone anywhere. So I'll scoop up His Holiness and follow behind.
So yeah, you guys go outside to the vans, and Alistair was just like chilling in the back of one of the vans with the doors open. And as you like go around to the back of the van, all that's there is Bear's machete.
Son of a bitch.
Oh, we left him alone. Oh, I'm gonna hurry up and go back to the kitchen.
You like sprint back to the kitchen, and Ross is there eating saltines, and Cricket's just kind of like staring down at her teacup drinking.
We lost Mr. Fancy Pants.
New rule, no splitting up.
Oh,
why? What happened?
He's gone.
We left him in the car. His machete is still there.
Where did you grab the machete? Just wondering.
I left it.
Okay.
Finch is literally just staring at Cricket, like confused and definitely uncomfortably too long.
Yeah, she can feel it. Like, she keeps doing that, like, that side eye where, like, she glances over at you without moving her head. She's like,
Finch. Finchy.
Hmm?
Finch.
What? Yeah?
You're being Ross level weird.
Oh, shit.
Ross eats another saltine cracker.
Hello, this is Tom, aka Ross Roberts. Just saying thank you for taking some time out of your day to listen to our podcast. We really appreciate it here at The Role Less Taken, and just want to encourage you, if you're interested, to follow us on our social media pages on Facebook and Instagram at The Role Less Taken, or on Twitter at Role Less Taken. Of course, role spelled R-O-L-E, because we are sly, punished people. Also, just want to again say thank you so very much. If you're comfortable and you feel like you've enjoyed the podcast, we would encourage you to leave a nice, happy little rating for us on any of those podcast distribution channels. And if you're not happy with us and you would like to let us know why, of course you can talk to us, yell at us, scream at us, paint a sad little tree, and leave it to us on any of those social media channels as well. Again, thank you so much. Looking forward to hearing from you. Bye.